In this video, we continue taking a look at some of the concepts from Chapter 6 on atmospheric moisture. And the concept we're focusing on in this video is the adiabatic processes. And the adiabatic processes tell us how air cools and warms at a standard rate as it increases in elevation and also as it descends. So if dry air is rising, it's going to cool at the dry adiabatic lapse rate, which is 10 degrees Celsius per 1,000 meters. If you wanted to use Fahrenheit to determine temperature differences between elevations, you could use the rate of 5.5 degrees Fahrenheit per 1,000 feet. But for our purposes, we're going to stick with Celsius and meters in the metric system. So imagine that you were at sea level at this point, and the temperature was 30 degrees Celsius. As the air rises 1,000 meters, the temperature will cool by 10 degrees Celsius, which will give us a new temperature here at 20 degrees Celsius. You also have a saturated adiabatic lapse rate. Once the air reaches the lifting condensation level, abbreviated LCL, or you might think of this as the point of saturation, or when the air reaches 100% relative humidity, when the process of condensation occurs, air here is dry but containing water vapor, and here air has cooled to the point, it's cooled to its dew point temperature, so that the air will change from, or the water will change from a gas into a liquid, and you'll have cloud formation and possibly precipitation as the air, if the air continues to rise and cool. So once you've reached this lifting condensation level, you're going to change from using the dry adiabatic rate to using the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, which is less than the dry rate at 6 degrees Celsius per 1,000 meters. So saturated air is going to cool more slowly than dry air. So if we were at 20 degrees Celsius here, the air rises 1,000 meters at the saturated adiabatic rate. So we subtract 6 degrees from that. If we went up another 1,000 meters, our new temperature here would be what? 20 degrees minus 6 degrees Celsius would give us 14 degrees Celsius at the new elevation of 2,000 meters. So, as we've already talked about in the chapter on the atmosphere, we know that as air rises in the troposphere, pressure is reduced and temperature drops. Until it reaches the lifting condensation level, it drops at the dry adiabatic rate. And then from that point on, if air continues to rise, it's going to cool at the saturated adiabatic rate. You've learned earlier about the environmental lapse rate, which does not have to do with air rising, but rather with you increasing your elevation or an airplane increasing its elevation. If the air itself isn't rising, then you're going to see a standard drop of 12 degrees Celsius. So let's say you're at the surface, you go hiking up a mountain to 1,000 meters, the new temperature there will be 28 degrees Celsius. You continue your hike up to 2,000 meters and you subtract that 12 degrees Celsius to get to 16 degrees Celsius. Hopefully that's making a bit of sense. The environmental lapse rate is different than the lapse rate that you'll use when the air itself is rising. So we'll switch to the dry adiabatic rate here at the surface if we're at 40 degrees Celsius. The air rises 1,000 meters. It's going to drop in temperature by 10 degrees Celsius, the dry adiabatic lapse rate, to 30 degrees Celsius. And if the air continues to rise, it's again at the dry rate, at 2,000 meters here, now we subtract 10, and our new temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. At 2,000 meters in this example, we've reached the lifting condensation level. So now we've switched to the saturated adiabatic lapse rate from 2,000 meters up to 3,000 meters, we're only going to subtract 6 degrees Celsius. So 20 minus 6 is 14 degrees at the new elevation of 3,000 meters. You continue using the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, subtract 6 degrees from 14, and your temperature at 4,000 meters will be 8 degrees Celsius. So, what we see oftentimes, and what could be confusing, is that on the windward side of a mountain, the temperature at sea level, or at the lowest elevation, will actually be less than the temperature on the leeward side, or the side that gets the rain shadow effect. So in this example, you have a 25 degrees Celsius at sea level. You increase your elevation by 1,000 meters, so you subtract 10 degrees according to the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Your new temperature, 15 degrees Celsius. If I increase my elevation another 1,000 meters, I'm going to subtract the dry adiabatic lapse rate, 10 degrees Celsius. I'm hoping that you're following along with me here. And my new temperature at 2,000 meters will be 5 degrees. Now I've reached the lifting condensation level. So now, what am I going to do to determine my temperature at the next altitude, 1,000 meters higher? If you said you're going to subtract 6, because that is the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, you're correct. 5 degrees Celsius minus 6 degrees Celsius is minus 1 degree Celsius. I continue, the air, I should say, continues to rise for another 1,000 meters. Again, I subtract 6 because the air is saturated, and minus 1 and minus 6 gives you negative 7 degrees Celsius. Now we're going to have a switch happening because the precipitation has been released here. And as we've discussed earlier, descending air warms. And so as air descends, what happens to its relative humidity? The water vapor capacity is increased. So we're going to switch over to the dry adiabatic lapse rate when we try to calculate the temperature of descending air. So if we started with negative 7 at 4,000 meters, the air descends 1,000 meters, I'm going to add the dry adiabatic lapse rate of what? Yes, 10 degrees Celsius. Negative 7 plus 10 is 3. Now I add another 10 degrees Celsius as I descend another 1,000 meters. 3 plus 10 gives me 13 degrees Celsius. Then I add another 10 degrees to get me to 1,000 meters, 13 plus 10 is 23, and the final 10 meters down to, I'm sorry, 1,000 meters down to sea level, I'm going to add another 10 degrees to give me 33 degrees Celsius on the leeward side of this mountain. So, again, an example where air is forced to rise over a topographic feature like a mountain, the windward side will have a cooler temperature than the same elevation on the leeward side of a mountain. And you see this if you look at a map of the United States. When air comes across, the westerlies come across the Pacific Ocean, the air rises and cools, and then so we have coastal Southern California that's more green and cooler. And then the interior of California, where you have Death Valley, where you get that rain shadow effect, very little precipitation and warmer temperatures than you have at the coast. So hopefully this helps you understand when you need to use the dry adiabatic lapse rate to calculate temperature, how you switch to the saturated adiabatic lapse rate at the lifting condensation level, and then you switch back to the dry adiabatic lapse rate as the air begins to descend. In the next video, we will be taking a look at precipitation mechanisms. So understanding this should help you with this next section.